Well, just because all of us have been asked, and we'll assume that the audience wants to know, your thoughts on Muhammad Ali before we get into the book.
Well, I knew that would come up. And I decided everything that could be said of consequence has already been said. In fact, it was said 20 years ago. And so I thought I would just tell a couple of little personal stories, which haven't seen the light of day yet. One time he went to sleep at Gabriel's restaurant down here.
Right.
He went to sleep with six or seven of us on my wife, who's here, on her shoulder.
He always had an eye for the ladies.
He did. Sometimes he would pretend to be asleep.
Yes.
And then wake up like this, and you didn't know. Yeah. And to a certain degree, a certain point, he could suddenly dance. You remember that?
Yes.
Just crazy. Another time I was with him, and we're four or five of us together in a hotel room, and I can't remember why, and everybody else left for one reason or another, and there I am sitting there with him, and there was a piano in the suite. And he walked over, and he played the Tennessee Waltz on the piano.
Wow.
I thought, where in the world did that come from? And that was it. That was the only song he played. I don't know, maybe it's... But a more touching story, which does relate to the way we changed our attitude about him. Mm-hmm. And you know, Bob, most athletes get a reputation in the beginning, and it's very hard for them to shake mm-hmm. that, whether it's good or bad. And I was doing a story on a guy named Howard Bingham, who was his friend. It was what Hollywood calls bromance. So many of his friends who had abandoned him when he was no longer a meal ticket. But Howard, who was a photographer, had stayed with him and really, along with Muhammad's wife, Lonnie, were the core of his life. And so we were in Washington, and the photographer taking pictures was Neil Leifer, who knows him well, and he suggested we go down to the monument, to the Vietnam Monument, and take a picture of Muhammad there. Mm-hmm. And I thought, oh my God. I mean, apart from Jane Fonda, who was identified more with dispute, with the war. And we went down there, and Neil is posing him, and there are already, it's pretty early in the morning, but there are a lot of people there, and obviously the people who were there tracing their fingers are looking for their loved ones who were killed. And they began to spot him and come toward him. And I thought, uh-oh, this is going to be trouble. Instead, they ran to him, embraced him, gave me their cameras, asked me to take a picture with the champ. It told me two things. Number one, how much the attitude toward him had changed, and also it was sort of the last gasp of the Vietnam War. Those are just some brief memories of Ali, a very significant but also a very complicated man.
Yeah, the arc of his life was extraordinary.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't know if any athlete, the arc, I don't know if any athlete has ever had it quite like that, or as I say, the attitude that the public changed so much.
You knew Arthur Ashe
Yes.
very well, better than I did, but I knew him fairly well, and he might be, all things considered, the most impressive athlete that I've ever known, a genuine intellectual, a person of high principle, but tennis did not give him the platform that baseball, especially in its time, gave Jackie Robinson, that boxing, which was still a mainstream sport until a generation ago, gave Muhammad Ali. And no matter how principled and admirable Arthur Ashe was, almost no one had the flamboyance, the magnetism, that the physical beauty that Ali had, it wasn't any one thing. It was the combination of things coupled with the context of his time, and then the complete sort of inside out of the most beautiful athlete and the most nimble athlete being rendered immobile, the most voluble athlete being rendered speechless, and yet somehow putting his vanity aside and being willing to come out on the public stage again at the 96 Olympics in Atlanta in that moment of reconciliation. And I think even most of those who excoriated him as a draft dodger and thought all the worst things had to say, you know what? All, taking it all into account, it's a hell of a man right here.
There was vanity, though.
Oh, yeah.
You talk about him lighting the torch. He loved a crowd. I mean, he couldn't stand to be alone. The first time I met him, I was a young writer, and we were riding back together from Albany to New York, where he had addressed the legislature. And he came over and sat next to me because he couldn't. There was nobody with him. And but I can remember when he could still move. I can see him on a street corner performing card tricks.
Yeah, he liked magic. He had that thing with the handkerchief, the red handkerchief,
yeah,
he'd make
same,
disappear.
The same thing. He told the same three jokes and did the same, and they were awful jokes too.
But it was Muhammad Ali telling him.
Ali, and there he was with a crowd of 10 or 12 people, happily performing these tricks. He loved the spotlight. We should never forget that.
Let's get to this, and eventually questions from the audience. This is an apt title. I'd know that voice anywhere. And because you were and still primarily are a writer,
yeah,
you surprised yourself that you didn't just have a serviceable radio voice. It turns out that in the minds of most listeners, it's a distinctive voice.
Distinctive. I don't know if it's any good, but it's distinctive. And I've tried to figure out why it's distinctive. Now, I grew up in Baltimore. And anybody who knows Baltimore, Philadelphia, that area, it's a very nasal sound, kind of like,
yeah,
this.
Right.
I mean, luckily, I didn't keep that. My mother was from the South, so I got some of the lilting from a tone from her. And then I moved on to Princeton and here in Manhattan, and I think I added some sophistication. I call it a sort of a domestic mid-Atlantic accent. That's the only way I can describe it. But people who don't know what I look like have literally, you know, like in a dark bar, not that I spend that much time in dark.
But all sports writers have spent some time in dark
true.
Bars.
Aren't you Frank Deford? And it's perfectly astonishing to me.
People may wonder how difficult it was for you to adapt a style, essentially a long-form style in Sports Illustrated, and in novels and books which you have written. These are minute and a half, 2-minute commentaries.
Well, they're 3 minutes.
3 minutes.
Give me that.
God, I wish I had 3 minutes more often.
I know,
TV.
It takes me a minute and a half to clear my throat. Actually, I never would have done it when NPR, you know, asked me out of the blue to do this if it had been another long-form thing, because it would have been a repetition of what I was already doing. And this was sort of a challenge for me. Remember, I had grown up in an era when the column in the newspaper was the premier thing in any paper, whether on the sports pages or otherwise. And so I was familiar. These are really columns, is what they are. It's just that I'm speaking them to you as opposed to you reading them. And I don't remember having a particularly difficult time switching, because it was so different than writing the long pieces. And you know you have to get it done, and it's also, someone said about columns once, and this is true here too, that writing a column, a regular column, remember now, I'm doing 52 of these a year. That's a lot. And it's like sitting under a windmill. And, you know, it comes around, and the flap comes, and you duck, and you go, And then you say, oh my God, here comes the next one. Because that's how fast it comes, that people say, how long does it take you to write one of these? And the answer is, it isn't so much in the, how long it takes to write, it's how long it takes you to figure out what in the world you are going to write.
Do you have 52 good ideas a year?
Do I have what?
52 good ideas a
year? No, good Lord, no. 50, if I set that judgment for myself, I would peter out by 2 or 3 months because you'd be so disappointed. I mean, that's like saying hit 52 home runs a year. I'm happy for 6 or 7 home runs and maybe a 400 hitter. And I know some of them, when I hand it in, I know it's just isn't very good. It's very ordinary, but you just can't expect, particularly in sports, which is a relatively finite institution. I mean, would that I could have someone like Donald Trump come along.
Once owned a team in the USFL.
But you always remember this with sports. You're dealing, as you know, with very young, unformed people who, by and large, have had nothing but success so far. And it's so, the very people who get the most attention, the stars, the players, are often the most boring. Not through any fault of their own, they're just young and immature.
Is that why some of your best, at least in my mind, and most memorable pieces have been about coaches?
Yeah.
Or I remember the piece The Boxer and the Blonde, where you look back on Billy Kahn's fights with Joe Louis. Of course, he was a younger man then, but this is through the rearview mirror. Or Howard Cosell toward the end of his career. There's more texture there.
No, absolutely no question. I learned that early on. That's not to say you get the occasional Arthur Ashe or Bill Bradley or someone like that. But even then, they haven't lived. And coaches are often failed players. Remember that.
Usually.
That's why they become coaches. And so they've gone through that experience. By the way, you mentioned Cosell. And I got along with Howard. I don't know why, but he suffered me.
It might have been the other way around.
Anyway, I would go visit him occasionally in the last sad years of his life when he was in some stage of dementia. And the last time I saw him, he was watching something silly on television, and he got up and he started going around the room picking various objects up, most of which were awards that he'd won and so forth, and showing them to me. And he came to something, and I don't even remember what it was, but he picked it up and held it carefully, and he said, "Frank, Muhammad Ali gave me this." And he started crying. He said, "Muhammad gave me this." And laid it back down and went over and started watching the television, and that was the last words I ever heard from him. But I think that answers the question. People always said, did Cosell and Ali really like each other?
They
did. I mean, it was a wonderful commercial symbiotic relationship, but there was real affection there.
I'm going to resist the temptation to delve deeper about Cosell, because that's a subject that could take up the rest of the night. Why are we, and it's one of the commentaries here touches upon this.
Yep.
Why are we so endlessly fascinated with sports? What's the hold that it has on so many people of so many different backgrounds?
Yeah, I've often said that, you know, people say, gee, what a great sports town this is, or we Americans are really sports crazy. Well, we're no more sports crazy than Brazilians or Romanians or anybody else. I think it's part of the human condition. It's the equivalent of art, music. No, it's not quite the same standard as eating and drinking and procreation, but it's the next level down. And I think, first of all, it is so very real. And maybe the fact that so much of life now is not real, or entertainment is not real, because it's digitalized and everything. And you go to the movies, you don't go to a live show. And I think that has a great deal to do with it, that this is something that's happening right before your eyes.
It also has an outcome. It has an outcome on an ongoing basis.
So
there's clarity in it.
It's clarity, and it's also identity. For example, people say, well, football is going to be like boxing. It's going to fade away because it's so brutal. No, because boxing has no identity. You may be for a boxer, but pretty soon he's gone. But you identify not only with the team in your city, but you identify with your college team, your high school team. And so, no, there is no way in the world we can wrench football away from those emotions.
You're probably aware of this. You and I have been characterized, not alone, but among those who have raised obvious questions based on the evidence about the ongoing dangers of football. And so at least we should have informed consent, not that it's wrong to play, but it was wrong that so many players played for so long unaware of the dangers to their minds. They were aware of the dangers to their bodies. They thought, you know, they might be arthritic when they were 50. They didn't think that they wouldn't know whether it was Monday or Tuesday, and increasingly we're finding that out. But what you also are probably aware of is that there are some people who believe that this is some sort of left-wing PC attack on football, which is the core of America.
Yeah, I think that's true, and I think football is, and I'll get in trouble for saying this, but there are, it is certainly more beloved in the South, which is conservative, more than it is anywhere else. Not to say that it isn't adored everywhere in America, but it's more of a Southern game. I think the affection, the meaning of it. Here, the Giants or the Jets lose, and everybody turns right away to the Knicks, unfortunately.
There's no solace there, though, right?
And that's a very brief interval, and then they turn to the Rangers or the Yankees and so forth. In the South, you know, they say there are only two seasons, the football season and spring practice.
And part of that, of course, is as you're mentioning, may have something to do with conservatism, but also because for a long, long time, there weren't any professional sports to speak of in the South. And these are, by and large, small college towns that not only had that as their only sporting interest, but the college gave the town its identity.
I got into a lot of trouble years ago writing about Bear Bryant, and part of the section that I wrote about was how the South was more warlike, and then a lot of this goes right back to the Civil War. It's produced more generals, more soldiers, and is thought of as more martial. And football, of course, is looked upon as a kind of war. And so that's another reason. I mean, maybe we're going too far over. But I think what's amazing is you say the players didn't realize they were, you know, risking their brains. It's amazing how we, the media, and the fans just sort of accepted it without ever thinking, gee, if a guy hits somebody going 30 miles an hour and the other guy's going 30 miles an hour, they might get hurt. I mean, we really didn't think about it.
Even though they were wearing helmets, and we now realize that a helmet will protect you against a skull fracture, but not against brain damage, because the brain still sloshes around like a pickle in a jar within the cranium. Yeah. But even though they're wearing helmets, we should have realized long ago that if it's been an accepted fact for the better part of a century that fighters become punch drunk, that why wouldn't the same thing ensue for at least some of them if they're being hit by even larger men and actually being hit more often than boxers are hit.
I had always heard the story or the analysis that if you were going to get knocked out as a boxer, better to get slugged in the first or second round rather than get pummeled for eight or nine rounds with little blows that build up. And of course, that's what football is, you know, so much of it in the line play. How we missed that, I don't know. I think we were just dumb blind. Of course, we also miss steroids in baseball, so we have trouble answering that too.
Which of your NPR commentaries has brought the most positive response? You still hear about it, people say, I love that. And which, or for which, did you catch the most hell?
The one that's probably the most popular was, I did Shakespeare Covers the Super Bowl.
Mm-hmm.
That was the year the Giants played the Patriots, and Manning, of course. Eli Manning versus Tom Brady. Another one that was really well-liked was about how everybody says guy now. And you say, well, what in the world's that got to do with sports? Well, sometimes I reach, you know, for some of those 52. I really reach. And I remember that a long time ago I did a story on Robin Smith, who was the first really good female jockey, subsequently married Fred Astaire. And she referred to women, girls, as guys. And that was the first time I'd ever heard that. And anyway, I wrote about how the whole world now, that they're only guys, that if the musical was written, it wouldn't be Guys and Dolls, it would be Guys and Guys.
That's a different show.
It's a
but I've seen it.
The ones that have drawn the most I'm looking for the right word, and any number of them that will apply, disgust perhaps. I don't like soccer. I just don't understand it. I don't understand the rest of the world, why everything we do with our hands. You know, Vermeer did not paint, right? and it's crazy that the most popular sport in the world is with the feet. Samuel Johnson said once that it was, after he saw a dog walking, he said it was amazing that a dog could walk on two legs, but even more amazing that he could do it well. And that's sort of where I look at soccer players, you know. And soccer people in the United States are very sensitive and defensive, Bob, because
yes,
we're the only place where soccer doesn't rule. And so to attack soccer immediately makes you some kind of American. I mean, well, super American.
Yeah.
You know, and oh boy, do I take a lot of heat for soccer. Oh.
You know, I don't dislike soccer, but the last part of what you said strikes home with me, because nobody goes to Brazil and says, "Hey, how come you guys aren't interested in the World Series? You know, why don't you care about the Stanley Cup Finals?" Well, because it's not as much a part of our culture. Now, soccer is becoming more and more popular, especially as a participant sport at the scholastic level, and it's wonderful. And obviously there's great dexterity and skill involved, et cetera, et cetera. But where is it written that it's a hostile act not to really be a fan of something? You're not saying it sucks. You're just saying, I, for whatever reason, I grew up liking baseball or basketball.
I'm sure if I grew up in Sao Paulo or Milano,
right,
I would be a soccer fan. But I think of a double play, 6-4-3 double play. That is so beautiful. Or a quarterback sitting there and throwing a 40-yard pass with guys climbing all over him, and a guy grabs it by his fingertips, right?
Yeah.
Okay, when you grow up seeing that, or Stephon Curry making 40, okay. And then you see a guy kick a ball for 10 yards. And he doesn't score, and they say, what a beautiful run that was.
It's known as the beautiful game.
Yeah, and that's like calling boxing the sweet science. I've never
which
understood
it was,
that either.
Which it was, A.J. Liebling called it that, right?
Anyway, I think maybe the fact that we use our hands in our sports is why we're, you know, and everybody else uses their feet is why we're the only superpower left.
Wow.
Trump can use that.
Here's the, you know, I'll say this, and I do see the beauty in the game and the excitement of the game, but I didn't grow up with it, so it's not my first sporting love. But one obstacle it faces in becoming more popular than it presently is in America is this. You can watch a hockey game, let's say, Sharks and Penguins. I think two of the games were 2-1 and the other was 3-2 in overtime. But there could be 50 scoring chances. So a lot of the action takes place where you're like this, and there has to be a terrific save. A huge portion of a soccer game takes place in the middle of a giant pitch, and there is no opportunity, nothing that makes you lean forward in your seat and say, here we go, this is the moment. There's not enough of those for American tastes.
And the offside, well, let's not even get into that.
All right, we've buried soccer here, which was not my intention.
By the way, as I understand it, after football concussions, the people who are at most jeopardy are young girls playing soccer.
The neck.
And hitting, I mean, that's crazy in itself that so many goals are scored by the head, but that I think could inhibit the popularity of soccer. People say, well, the kids will start to play soccer, but I'm not so sure that's a good idea either.
I'm fairly sure now that the vacancy at the top at FIFA will not be filled by Frank DeFord, so we'll move on. You know, when you mentioned Shakespeare goes to the Super Bowl, that's a cousin of Gilbert and Sullivan taking a ball game, right?
That's right. Can I do Gilbert and Sullivan?
That was sort of the batting practice fastball I was throwing.
I did Gilbert and Sullivan. I did an opera once. As I say, when you got to do 52 a year, you do start to reach after a while. And this, anyway, is Gilbert and Sullivan when they first saw a baseball game. Oh, the grass is green and the base is white and the players pitch and hit. But more than that, alas, alack. They only prefer to spit to spit. They only prefer to spit. For while bowlers bowl and golfers golf and those on the ice go skate, the baseball player takes bat and glove, but would rather expectorate. Rather would expectorate. I am the very model of a baseball star. I hit them hard and I hit them far. No, not a swimmer, nor a sprinter, nor a skier, nor a point guard too. For I'm lean and mean and fit as a fiddle, ready to show the world my spittle, ready to show the world my spittle. Thank you.
I should have remembered that I circled this when I asked you earlier about why we love sports so much, but a guy from your hometown, famous writer and cynic, his name is almost synonymous with cynicism, H.L. Mencken, said, I hate sports as rabidly as a person who likes sports hates common sense.
And, you know, that's okay. I mean, that relates to what we were talking about, individual sports. It doesn't bother me when people come up and say, I really don't like sports. Okay, mm-hmm. That's fine. I think, though, that more and more people like sports, particularly women, has changed their whole attitude. That in my years, my many years covering sports, that's the most important change by far.
One of the nicest compliments you can receive, and I always appreciate it when I occasionally receive it, and I'm sure you get it even more frequently, is people will begin, often it's a woman, but sometimes
yes.
it's a man, will begin like this. You know, I'm not that much of a sports fan, or I don't follow sports that closely, but I enjoy what you do. And I take that to mean that however imperfectly I may do it, that I'm doing it in a way that is not confined to the sports nerd. It will include that person, but you broaden it out. You try to find some human dimension or some element to it that brings some texture to it. At least that's what you're trying to do.
Well, that's true, but unfortunately, a writer friend of mine said, Deford, the people who like you best don't understand what you're talking about. So keep that in mind next time, Bob.
One of the commentaries in here that I enjoyed was student athletes, STOODINT, ATHALEETES, student athletes.
That's a great sham, either one, both. And I could probably do that every week because among the many sins of college sports, and amateurism is at the top of the tree, but it's foolish to think that so many of the kids playing major sports, and we're not talking about a lot of athletes, we're talking about football players and basketball.
Primarily.
Yeah, absolutely, the revenue sports, which is what they are.
Because generally speaking, male or female, in the other sports, as a group, the athletes are better students,
oh, yes.
generally speaking, than the rest of the student body as a generalization.
But the football and basketball players, I mean, Mary Willingham, who was a tutor at North Carolina and practically ostracized for it, said that she was handed athletes, and this is Carolina, which is one of our finest state institutions, mm-hmm. Just a magnificent place of learning, who were essentially illiterate. And yet somehow they had gotten in to Chapel Hill. And don't think for a minute that the University of North Carolina is alone in that regard. That I'm sure that it's even worse at a lot of places. And it's foolish. We ought to let these kids major in football or major in basketball, or say, okay, you want to go to class? You've got 4 years here. You can do whatever you want. You want to go to class? Fine. If you just want to sleep and lift weights, that's fine too. But we ought to drop the hypocrisy of it because it's foolish, and the terrible thing is it starts in high school.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's not like they get to college and all of a sudden it's a sham. It starts at a very, very young age, and it's just sinful.
It's obvious to anyone who has watched the various work you've done on HBO. Listen to these commentaries. Some of them are whimsical. Many of them are appreciative. Others are critical, but not in a harsh way, in a thoughtful way. It should be obvious that you enjoy sports, at least
yes.
in your own fashion. And you have seen the value, not just in the games, but in many of the people involved with the games. But having said that, there's nothing contradictory about sometimes even reveling in the beauty and wonder and shared experience of sports, but recognizing that since it's a human enterprise, it's flawed, and there are issues there that have to be commented on or taken on journalistically. And yet you know, now at HBO and Real Sports, that the audience is kind of self-selected, But if I occasionally venture out on that limb to a broad audience, I'm willing to do it, but there's a price to pay. That a lot of people just said, this is sacred ground. Don't spoil it with politics in any way. Well, what was Muhammad Ali's life about? What was Jackie Robinson's life about? What was Arthur Ashe's life about? Or Billie Jean King? Or the very issues you're just talking about? How can you do an entire NCAA tournament? Listen, if I was calling a Final Four game, I wouldn't be talking about this issue with the game on the line with 10 seconds to go. But somewhere in there, in those hundreds and hundreds of hours and those zillions and zillions of statistics, graduation rates never mentioned once, the whole dynamic that you're talking about, which is as plain as the nose on your face, never mentioned once. We can do better than this, can't we?
Nor, as a matter of fact, does it come up when guys, and there have been entirely too many recently, and particularly in football, have assaulted women, you know, gotten into gunfights or whatever, and that's never alluded to. It's sort of, he had a little trouble.
Don't intrude upon the game.
Yes.
Or here's a euphemism. The quarterback has been suspended, even though the coach perhaps wishes he could get around it. He's been suspended because he's been arrested. And 10 players have been declared academically ineligible. And here is the question. How have you dealt with all these distractions?
Distractions.
As if they just came like a swarm of locusts and you had nothing to do with it.
Distractions. That's a great word. Yeah. The only thing better than that is when the coach says that he's stepping down to spend more time with his family.
and then turns up someplace else a month later.
Yeah, football coaches, you know, they love to pillory themselves. They've got to be watching more film than every other coach in the country. They can't, and their associates are supposed to work till midnight and go home and be back in the office at 4 o'clock. Football coaches are really crazy people.
Many of them are.
Many of them are.
Yeah. All right, so I hold in my hand questions from the audience. So here we go. Who was the athlete who turned out to be most unlike what you had expected?
Oh, most unlike in terms of intelligence or
doesn't specify, so it's open-ended.
I'm flummoxed. I can't think of somebody, and there's a reason for that, because the story that I would do on someone would be, I would already have a pretty good idea. I can think of one incident, though. Hank Aaron, as you know, a very reserved gentleman,
yes,
and certainly did not go out of his way to court the press, even though he was polite with us. And we did a charity dinner one time. I think Ted Turner had made him do it when he owned the Braves. And a car drove us back to the hotel. And I said goodnight and headed to my room. And he said, "Hey, don't you want to have a beer?" And I sat there with Hank Aaron for 3 or 4 beers. And he just opened up. I mean, we just talked. And I had never expected that in a million years. So I guess that would be the incident that I remember the most.
Deeply decent man.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, he's Babe Ruth. I mean, Roger Maris is the home run champion for one season in my mind, and Hank Aaron is the champion of all time in my mind.
I agree with that completely. Yeah. Agree with that completely. And so do two people in the audience. What's the greatest sports moment you've ever witnessed?
Oh, that's easy. You you immediately, I think almost everybody, goes back to their youth to find the most beloved times in sport. I mean, it's like the music of your life. You remember the growing up. I knew I was really old when the oldies but goodies were were so old that I couldn't hear them anymore. And I grew up in Baltimore, and Johnny Unitas leading the Baltimore Colts over your own New York Giants at Yankee Stadium in the greatest game ever played.
The overtime game, first NFL overtime game.
Yeah, that, I mean, nothing could touch that. I could, you know, all the years I've been a professional journalist, if that's a 10, nothing else is a 7. I mean, it's that far above.
What do you think of the recent trend, this is a good question, of athletes self-publishing on sites like the Players Tribune? Ooh. Many of you may be familiar with this. Derek Jeter started it.
Yeah.
And it's a place where players can just post, whether they write it themselves or they dictate it to someone who puts it together for them. Instead of being interviewed or interpreted by someone else, they just make their own statement.
For the press, that's scary, because we've always been the middleman, you know, and it went to look at it in a harsh light. And all of a sudden, we're avoided, we're jumped over, we're unnecessary. And I think also, it's something that the public will suffer, because you're not going to get the truth. You're going to get statements, and you need a press to cover baseball or soccer or religion or science or anything else. And you can't just let the scientists come out and say, well, I've invented such and such. And that's basically the analogy here.
See, I'm okay with it as long as it is an addition to rather than a replacement for. If it becomes a trend and it's a replacement for objective perspectives, then I don't think that's a good thing. But there can be worthwhile installments on the Players Tribune.
After all, athletes have been writing
memoirs,
books for many years. And it's somewhat similar to when television first began to come in, and players would say, I'll go on television, but I won't talk to the newspapers because they always get it wrong. But on television, they could control things better.
Because they're less apt to be misquoted.
So it's just an extension of that.
Well, an extension of this question. What do you make of some of the trends in present sports writing which are influenced by technology?
Well, I think there are more better sports writers than ever before, and I might also say more better announcers. I think your profession has been raised as well, but the problem is numbers. Oh my God, we're just overwhelmed by numbers, and in that case, the humanity goes out, and it's the humanity and the personality and the character and all that. It's just, that's what makes not just sports writing, but any kind of writing about people terrific. And if all we ever read were numbers, and that's the shame of it.
You know, I've always been interested in sabermetrics. I read Bill James when he was mimeographing his stuff out of his house in Kansas in the late 70s and early 80s. But like anything else, it has to be used with some discretion, especially in a broadcast. They hit you with this tsunami of numbers, and you've got to go through it and say, what really tells something of interest here? What's significant here? And even if 20 things are of some significance, if you're going to get to all of them, you're going to sacrifice, in the big sense, how the weather is. Look at the hat that lady is wearing. Look at that little kid with the ice cream cone. That really is, in addition to his innate talent, that sensibility is the key to Vin Scully's enduring greatness and popularity. He doesn't need to tell you what the launch angle is. He doesn't need StatCast. He doesn't really refer to the radar gun that much. Before the radar gun existed, you knew that Sandy Koufax's fastball had hop on it by the way that Vin Scully described it. You know, and I think the fact that what he does and what you did for so long at Sports Illustrated is almost a counter to the prevailing kind of short attention span. It slows things down and says, take a little time to appreciate. Take a little time to notice the telling detail. I think a lot of people appreciate that, but younger people haven't grown up with much of that. Now, this is not a get off my lawn thing, okay? This has nothing to do with technology. If something was good, it was good when it came off Gutenberg's printing press. If it was a lie, or if it was lousy, it was a lie if someone carved it on the wall of a cave with a jagged rock. Okay, so it's only generational that you and I probably prefer to hold the newspaper in our hands
yes.
and read with a cup of coffee in the morning. It doesn't matter if you get it on a tablet, but it damn sure matters if it's true or not, if it's credible, if it's fair, and if there's some quality attached to it. That's what matters.
And I'm afraid that the sports writers that are coming into the game today have grown up so much with numbers that they don't see the personal side of things so well. And everything is described statistically.
Numbers and snark, too. And there's a big difference between irreverence or sarcasm wielded effectively and just snark.
Oh, well, that's the internet. People write things that they shouldn't. And it's editors. As much as I can despise editors and fight them all my life, we need them, and that's what you don't have on the internet.
You know, so many longtime newspaper writers who haven't yet lost their jobs because newspapers are going under, which is sad. But so many of them have said to me that editors used to come up to them and say, that was a really good story, but you needed another quote from the mayor. Or, that was a terrific story, best thing you've ever done, do more of that. Now, almost exclusively, the only thing they hear is, that got the second most clicks of anything in the sports section. Whatever has the most heat as opposed to the most light is gonna get more clicks.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's taken us down an unfortunate path, I think.
There was an old newspaper man named Gene Fowler who said, every editor should have a pimp for a brother so they would have someone in the family to look up to.
Wow. On the other hand, we see that everything's relative because without an editor, even though somewhere out there in the big morass of stuff, there's quality stuff, thoughtful stuff, interesting stuff, humorous stuff all over the internet. But there's absolutely no accountability and there are no editors, and an editor would be welcome in some cases. Not just
That's
to trim
what
stuff
I said
down.
That originally.
Yeah.
Okay.
Not just to trim stuff down, but to rein some stuff in.
Yeah. I just quoted Mr. Fowler.
That was funny. It was funny. What was the toughest story you've ever had to cover? Thanks, says Danny Ratner. The other people I didn't ignore, they didn't put their names on it. Danny did.
God, toughest story is when someone won't talk to you. And again, I'll fall back on a let me preface it by saying, first of all, international stories are the hardest because nothing is worse than when you're interviewing someone and there's a translator in between. I did a piece for Real Sports in which I got to interview in Nicaragua the number two guy, and yet and I was asking him real tough questions, and you know, real.
Yeah.
Yeah, tough guy, Mike Wallace. Yeah. And nothing. But this is a story that tells us a lot about the press and everything else. When I was a kid reporter, I was sent up to Boston to do a profile on Tony Conigliaro, who of course later was tragically beamed and so forth. But at that time, he was, you know, the new Babe Ruth. I mean, this kid was fabulous.
Handsome.
Everything. And he was only like, I think 19 or 20 years old or something like that.
He led the league in homers when he was 20.
And he had been, you know, the Boston press, there were then, I think, six papers in Boston. And they just, you know, he was tired. He didn't want to talk to anybody else. He didn't care whether it was a national magazine or not. And he just wouldn't talk to me. There was an old newspaper man named Cliff Keene. Mm. Poison pen Keene.
He gave Ted Williams a tough time,
and
right?
He gave everybody a tough time. And he goes down, he says, come with me. And he goes down to the Red Sox locker room and he corners Conigliaro. And he says, listen to me, son. This gentleman came all the way from New York to talk to you, and you will sit down and talk to him. And damned if he didn't. And can you imagine today a newspaper man, telling, Mike Trout that? I don't think so.
Probably not.
If people won't talk, you can't make them talk, and it becomes very difficult.
What was the biggest thing you took away from your college years at Princeton?
I have to admit that I wish I could go back and do college over again because I blew it. All I wanted to do was write, and I didn't take advantage. I mean, Princeton's a pretty good place, and there are a lot of smart people there, What I did in my 4 years at Princeton was, it might as well have been a trade school. I worked on the newspaper, wrote stories, wrote plays, and then with my left hand, I went to class.
Turned out okay.
Yeah. So, I wish I could say that what I took out of Princeton was the great knowledge and that I learned, and I didn't. I have to be honest and say that. I know that nobody expected to hear that answer, but that's true.
There were no women there then.
And which would have been even more of a distraction. So, I mean, it was hard enough for me to concentrate on my studies when, all I really wanted to do was right. I will say one funny thing. I was a pretty good high school basketball player. And this is where I found out, by the way, that at each level, water, all right. And I got to Princeton and it doesn't take much. I wasn't quite quick enough to get off that beautiful shot that I could in high school, I couldn't even get it off. And the coach at Princeton told me, he said, Deford, you write basketball better than you play it. Which I already knew, so it wasn't exactly a bombshell.
You know, that is among, though, the poignant stories that every generation produces, that the kid who is a genuinely terrific player at a certain level. And it's what defines usually him, increasingly her, at that early stage of their lives, that's what defines them. It's how they view themselves. And then they have to come to grips with the fact that as they move up to the next level, or maybe the level after that, they're just average, or maybe can't even make the team.
I know. It's every level. It's so funny. And it's also true that there are a few people, and you know it, who like a minor leaguer, who suddenly blossoms when he gets to the big leagues.
Mm-hmm.
And and those are, you know, people who develop late. I mean, it's amazing to me, for example, that Stephon Curry, with the genes that he had, his father, mm-hmm. right, and obviously skinny, growing late, was not recruited by a big-time college.
Played at Davidson.
Yeah. And then they make the same mistake all over again in the pros. I mean, he went fifth or sixth or something like that. But it's just it's extraordinary that they couldn't see that. I think the hardest thing in sports is to divine who's going to be great and who isn't.
Joe Montana went in the third round.
Johnny
Tom Brady United. Was 199th.
Johnny Unitas was cut by the Pittsburgh Steelers. And there are just as many quarterbacks who were drafted, one or two, who
you know, one of the things, though, that sometimes annoys me is when people say, if someone who was genuinely terrific in college does not do well in the pros, he was overrated, he's a fraud. No, they're different games. Yeah. Bill Bradley, Princeton guy like you, was one of the greatest college basketball players ever. And it wasn't because he played in the Ivy League, because he excelled in the NCAA tournament as well against competition from all over the country. He was a very good but not great NBA player, part of a great team, and because of his intellect, he was able to accept that. And he reveled in the fact that he was part of this kind of jazz ensemble that the Knicks of the early 70s were. Doug Flutie was legitimately the Heisman Trophy winner. He was a journeyman player, though he had a very long career, because he wasn't as suited to the NFL. But that doesn't mean that what he did at Boston College was fraudulent.
No, absolutely. And it is unfair that we should expect somebody at one level to duplicate that at the next.
Even if he loses the finals, is LeBron still the best basketball player ever? I was unaware that was the consensus, much as we love LeBron. Michael Jordan faction, Wilt Chamberlain faction will be heard from, Magic Johnson, Larry Bird.
I think it's so hard to judge people in different eras, even though, what is it, just 15 years that separates him from Jordan. For my money, Jordan was the greatest. But I can't argue with someone who says LeBron is. But to answer that particular question, the number of championships that a guy wins should not measure in a team sport mm-hmm. how good he is. I covered basketball in the 1960s, and I saw Jerry West lose 6 or 7 finals to the Celtics. And let me tell you, by the end of his career, Wes was the best player in basketball. And the Celtics would tell you the same thing. And yet people are still saying, oh, that Wes, you know.
He was tortured by it, too.
Yeah, but he was up against a better team. And so if LeBron loses in 4 straight, I don't think it has any bearing whatsoever on how great he is.
This next questioner would like you to talk about Sports Illustrated in its earlier days, and I hope I'm pronouncing this correctly. I've seen it in print a zillion times. Andre Laguerre.
Andre Laguerre was de Gaulle's press secretary during the war. Before that, he had been fished out of the English Channel, escaping Dunkirk. He was a Frenchman. He did spend a lot of his youth in the United States because of his father was the French consul in San Francisco. But the magazine was struggling, and many people thought it was going to be folded. And when Laguerre took it over after about 6 or 7 years, and he was just, you know, I've said nasty things about editors. He was just an extraordinary editor and a fascinating, fascinating man. I mean, they just don't make them like that anymore. I mean, this almost mythic figure. But it is true, that he made Sports Illustrated. And for those of you who are fans of the swimsuit issue, that's so funny the way that developed. You know, nobody sat around and said, hey, I got an idea. In February, we'll put a beautiful girl on the cover and we'll put her in a bathing suit. No, nobody thought of that, even though nothing went on in February then. You know,
right.
Yeah.
Fallow
period. What happened was we used to do travel stories in Sports Illustrated. And this one particular year, they had the cover was a young woman coming out of the surf. And if I showed you that picture now, it was closer to a burqa than a bikini that she was wearing. I mean, I just, you know, and it wasn't like, you know, she was this statuesque. No, she just was a pretty attractive. But we got some mail. A librarian in South Carolina said she couldn't put that kind of pornography in. And some guy was right. going to cancel it. And Laguerre, they brought these letters to Laguerre. And he thought Americans were kind of prudes anyhow. And he said, wait till next year. And within about 5 years, there was Cheryl Teagues in that fishnet outfit. And that's how the swimsuit issue started.
I always looked forward not so much to the swimsuit issue, but to the letters. Afterwards, the letters of outrage. No. And they often came from school librarians.
Yes.
You know, how can we have this alongside, you know, blah, blah, blah. And now it's entirely separate. The swimsuit issue yeah. has no other editorial content. So, and I believe you can actually, if you subscribe, opt out of that one just so that it doesn't taint your mailbox.
Yes. One time with Laguerre, we were in the bar. That was usually where he could be found when he wasn't in his office. And he seldom talked about himself. And the subject of airplane crashes came up. There had just been an airplane crash. And he's sitting there with his scotch and his cigar, and he says, much to all our surprise, he said, I was in an airplane crash once. And I was dumbfounded. And I said, where was it, Andre? He said, well, I was flying from Paris to London. We crashed right outside of Heathrow. I said, what did you do? He said, I took a cab, Frankie. they don't make them like that.
Here is how this question is phrased. Will baseball remain America's pastime for years to come? And if the word pastime is the operative word, I think the answer to that could be yes. But if it's, to my regret, the question, the most popular sport, football has won that overwhelmingly.
By a larger margin all the time. But I always think it's important to point out that it isn't so much that baseball has gone down.
Baseball's gone up, actually.
Yeah, it's gone up. I mean, it's the attendance and all that sort of thing. And basketball and football have gone up. I do get a little annoyed, Bob, when you hear baseball people say, well, you know, there's no clock in baseball. I don't know what that has to do with anything, but but I always say, yeah, but the people in the stands have watches.
And I have always enjoyed, from the time I was a kid, the proper leisurely pace of baseball. But now it's too often a lethargic pace.
Yeah.
And it isn't even time of game, it's pace. If a game took 3 hours and that game was 10-9 and it was packed with action, that's one thing. But if a game is 3-2 and there's 12 pitching changes and it takes 3 hours and 20 minutes, and I love baseball, except if I'm doing the game, I cannot stick with every pitch.
There you go. That's exactly my point. And why they can't enforce the time limit that a pitcher has.
With no one on base.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's the 24-second clock in basketball saved the NBA and then college ball, and a tennis player has to serve in a certain amount of time, and a golfer has only so long. And so why they can't just simply enforce that rule is beyond
me. I think one of the things that works against, and baseball is really trying to pick up the pace, is what works strategically is not the best for entertainment. You have so many hard throwers now that contact is less. You're just less likely to make contact on the first or second pitch. So the strikeout rates are higher, the walks are higher, or even if you don't get a walk, you go deep into the count before you make contact, and then there are all the pitching changes. That's what works strategically. Joe Torre's Yankees did it on purpose. They tried to go as deep into the count as possible to get the starting pitcher out before the closer, to get to the lesser relievers in the middle. It works strategically. It dragged games out.
No. They've got to correct it. They've got to make it faster. That's all. Simple as that. I don't think they really understand that the average fan is you know, slumbering.
Indulge me one short story before the last question here. My son Keith works, and it's a great treat for me. He works at the Major League Baseball Network, and he's an associate producer, but he started out as a statistician. So 4 or 5 years ago, he's in the booth with me at Fenway Park, and it's one of those taut Yankee-Red Sox games, but Jim Cott used to refer to them as 4 hours of drama and trauma, and they always went on and on. So now here is Mariano Rivera trying to close the game out, and it's a one-run game, and there are runners on first and second with two outs, and we're 4 hours into the game. And, you know, you try to have some fluids to keep your voice where it should be, and you're reaching middle age, and you're really not looking forward to extra innings because you got other things to do. And, you know, there's a cough button, and Adrian Gonzalez was then with the Red Sox. Two out, two on, one-run game, all right? And I pushed the cough button, and I looked at Keith, and I said, this son of a bitch can strike out to end the game. He can homer to win the game. He can double in the gap to win the game. But if he singles to tie the game, you're doing the 10th. All right.
Did Bo get him out?
Yeah, he got him out.
Okay.
And I got out of the booth as fast as possible. Who is your favorite, flip side of the earlier question about the toughest, who's your favorite all-time interview subject?
Al McGuire.
Oh, I loved him.
I can say that. Ash was the most fascinating, interesting, brilliant, intellectual, and so forth. But McGuire had a language all of his own, and he was just different. And he also had a habit, and the only person I've ever met in my life, of saying your name all the time. But he'd say it twice. It's not like I would say to you, Bob, I've enjoyed being with you this evening. He would say, Bob, I've enjoyed being with you this evening, Bob. And after a while, I started doing the same thing. Al, where are we going today, Al? Frank, I thought we'd go to the deli, Frank. And I mean, just, but he was special, and I could have talked to him, you know, forever.
You know what he also did, and you want to, obviously an ideal subject for somebody like
that. Yeah, oh yeah.
Because quirky, but so human and so decent and so compassionate and funny. I mean, the whole thing. I mean, there were all the different shadings in this guy, and he was an original. But one of the things he'd do, he'd bestow nicknames on everybody as a sign of affection. If you got a nickname, then you knew that you ranked in some sense with him. And when I was just starting out at NBC, 1980, 81, Dick Enberg was the number one guy. There were a couple of early season basketball games, college basketball games, that he worked with Billy Packer. They were a really popular team, the threesome of Enberg, Packer, and McGuire. But in December, Dick would sometimes have to do NFL games. And they plucked me out of the chorus line to fill in for Enberg. And so I called a couple of North Carolina, Indiana games and DePaul, UCLA. It was a big deal for me. I was 28 and looked like I was 11. And so after the first game, McGuire throws his arm around my shoulder and he said, "You did a good job, Yellow Pages." And then I realized he thought I needed to sit on a phone book to call the game. And every time he saw me, "Hey, Yellow Pages, how are you?"
You know, he didn't know the names of many of his players.
That's also true.
I mean, a guy was a junior, but he would still, if he came from Moline, Illinois, he would remember that. He would say, "Moline," you know, to send a guy into the game. The expressions he had. His assistant coaches really did all the coaching, you know, except during the game. And he said, "I tell him, only one of us can wear you. Only one of us can wear the brassiere." Damn, I knew what he meant. That was the crazy thing. By that time, I knew what he meant. Only one of us can wear the brassiere.
I still don't know what he means.
It means, you know, don't step forward, huh? Don't. I'm out there front and center.
Last one, just kind of round things out here. What story is out there, whether it be for HBO Real Sports or a long form piece or a book you'd like to write? What story is out there that you haven't mined yet?
Oh. Well, soccer in America. Gosh, Bob. I think writing about, and it wouldn't sell, but writing about children's sports today and how it's changed is important. I mean, it's kids today. If they're any good at all, their parents force them into one sport.
Yeah.
They're too much pressure on them at too young an age. All the stuff we've talked about scandalous academics, which are getting lower and lower down. The attitude that some kids at a very young age have toward referees, you know. And just generally, the lowering of standards.
Well, that last part, and again, when you make this observation, and I don't quite understand the thought process, when you speak out in favor of grace or civility, that's somehow like an old-fashioned or retrograde notion. I don't get that.
No, I completely agree with you, and referees are I've always admired referees and what they do, and these kids today, you know, really snotty, and from an early age, and the parents are screaming at the referees from the sidelines, and I just worry, and I haven't even mentioned whether we should let boys play football. And so I think that's a real wide open subject, and nobody wants to read it though.
But all of you are gonna wanna read this. I'd know that, thank you for the straight line. I'd know that voice anywhere. My favorite NPR commentaries. The beauty of this is you could devour it all in one sitting, or you could just come to it, you know, a page or two at a time. And if Frank was to include, or his editor, You must love your editor here.
Yeah,
it was
yeah.
pretty simple. All I had to do was reprint it, right?
I had to write a foreword. Yeah.
But all the well-deserved accolades. Peter King says Deford is the Holy Grail. He's simply one of the greatest sports writers of all time. Frank Deford says Tony Kornheiser is the best sports writer I've ever read. If there's a Mount Rushmore of sports writing, Deford is up there, purple ties and all. And if you've ever seen Frank on television, there's always some purple in the wardrobe, and even his watch, even the watch is lavender or something in color. But if I were you, even with David Mariner saying that you hold a special place at the top, not very bright, someone said of him long ago at Princeton, it was true, he's turned out to be brilliant instead, all fine. But if I were you, this is the one I would want. The Chicago Sun-Times, Deford, is the handsome, swashbuckling man of sports journalism. For 50 years, he's been issuing perhaps the greatest writing the realm has known. Swashbuckling. Because this is hardly an original observation. There has always been kind of an Errol Flynn quality about you.
Well, Bob, thank you very much, Bob.
Frank, you're welcome, Frank. My pleasure. Thank you all very much. And Frank will be available immediately, I guess, or soon, to sign books someplace